Wonderful. Okay, got it. Recording in progress. I love the way this machine tells you all these things that are going on. I thought I'd just start with a little bit of background about the transitions program, because not everybody knows about it here on Galiano. It was started in 2007 by Jan Adler and Terry Gregory. And they were really looking at creating support for people who were in that transition period where there was grieving about illness and about death. So the Transitions for Grieving and Dying group was formed, and there was some training initially for a group of about 8 to 10 volunteers who actually provided support to families and people who were ill here on the island. And they were quite active for many years, and then variety of reasons, people moved, people changed and focus, and things changed. Jan is currently off the island for a period of time, and so Linda Zingaro and I are co-leading the transitions group, and it has changed a lot. We are no longer at the moment providing support for people who are ill and dying, but we provide a lot of educational forums. We've run groups for people who have been recently widowed or are now on their own, or perhaps they've lost a family member. And so we are very much focused on not only dying, but also living, because Linda and I have hosted at least one advanced care planning workshop, and we'll probably do more over Zoom as our skills improve. But we thought that this opportunity to talk about, because I hear this a lot from seniors. Some of you may know that I also coordinate the Better at Home program here. And a lot of people say to me, you know, I don't want to go off the island at the end of my life. I want to stay at home. I want to die on Galiano. And so it's sometimes more complicated than just, but you know, there's things to consider and things to plan for. So we thought the Jan Adler and Linda and I have talked about this for quite some time now. And it's been wonderful to be able to gather together this extraordinary group of people. We have everybody's very involved in death and dying and supporting families and friends and patients. And so, I guess this is the start of a conversation about how can we do this in a way that's supportive for everybody and helps people. How could I put this? How can we here on Galiano as a community provide space for people to do their last bit of life here in a way that they want to do it? So I'm going to just introduce, let me just tell you a little bit about the format. We've got four people on our panel. Dr. Erin Carlson, who many of you may know because she is our family physician here on the island. Dr. Romaine Gallagher, Leanne Drumheller, and Linda Zingaro are all going to talk about different aspects of palliative care. And so I'll just briefly introduce them in the order that they'll talk. And we will have time at the end for questions. I did think, actually, I was surprised to hear that part wasn't going to be recorded, because those conversations are often one person asks a question, there's probably other people that are thinking exactly the same thing. And so anyway, so we will do our best to keep you informed about what people are talking about and curious about. If you have a question, write it down or somehow keep it in your mind so that, and I think the best way that this happened is if you type it into the chat box. And if you're familiar with Zoom, you know that at the bottom, if you put your cursor on the screen, whoop, there it is, just beside the participants, there's the chat box. So you can put it in there, and Lori, our tech wizard, will find that, and Leslie's watching for those as well.
So let me just introduce. Nancy, yep. Sorry to interject, but also if folks want to ask their question live, you can just Let me know that you've got a question you'd like to ask, and I can open your camera and put okay. you on the center. So
that's great. That's even better. So in the moment, you can ask a question. That's perfect. Because I always forget the question, so I like to ask right away. So let me just start with Erin Carlson. I was reading something that Erin had written about herself online, and she said she's passionate about family practice, and in particular has a real interest in rural family medicine. And I think, you know, Galiano doesn't seem that far away, but we are really considered rural and remote as a community because we don't have a lot, the breadth of services that we have in a more urban area. So Erin's been here for, I'm going to say 8 years, but is that long? And you probably seen Erin with her wonderful kids and her great husband. And they're a valuable part of our community here. Romaine Gallagher is a doctor of longstanding, and I would say, Romaine, an expert in the area of palliative care. And I think it's really interesting that you have also got also involved in the virtual hospice program, which is, I think, very appropriate that in this day and age that we have a virtual hospice as well as real-time ones. And I also read that you're not only an advocate for palliative care in your own practice, but on a national and a provincial level as well, which is exciting to know. So Leanne Drumheller is a social worker, and she is currently the psychosocial consult for the palliative and end of life care team, which works out of Island Health. And if I'm correct, Leanne, it's you're sort of based in Saanich in the Gulf Islands and Saanich, Victoria area in the Gulf Islands, supporting families and patients towards end of life, and particularly palliative care. And Linda Zingaro, who is our co-lead for the transitions program, is a counselor and a consultant of many, many years experience. And what did I find out about you, Linda? The real focus on community service delivery, which I thought was really kind of, that's very cool. And the way I know Linda is mostly through her hospice work and her passion for singing at the bedside. And her compassion and skill in leading our confidential conversation group during this time of COVID has been a real godsend to our community. And so she's going to speak later on about the, not quite sure, but probably the emotional spiritual aspect of caring for ourselves at the end of life. So I do have an agenda, and I haven't been looking at my clock, but I think we're well under time here. I'm going to give people a little bit of a heads up here. We're going to kind of try and keep it on time, but you never know, things kind of go sideways sometimes. So if you have a question, put it in the chat box. You can see Lori's put something down here already. And there we go. Okay. Without any further ado, I'm going to stop talking and let Erin talk to you. Now, I've given people just a bit of a guideline, but, you know, Erin will fill in the blanks and share with us your expertise. Thanks, Erin.
Thanks, Nancy. Thanks for having us. Thanks to the library. And so I was tasked with just talking a little bit about going through the dying process and receiving palliative care at home on Galiano, and a bit about what that looks like and how that can be done, if that can be done, and everything like that. So I'll just go with that. Basically, it can really be a rewarding and beautiful and special time for a family who is losing somebody, to have them at home and be able to support them all the way through until the very end. And palliative care can allow that to happen. I think the main thing to know on Galiano Island, because of our challenges with resources, is that it does take a loving, willing, and dedicated proverbial village to be with the person who is going through the dying process, and with their family. It takes so much dedication to watch for symptoms of that are uncomfortable, to respond to those symptoms and connect with the care, the healthcare people that the family is working with, get answers, get help when they need it. What we do is we do our best to give as many resources as possible to the people who are dying and their family, or their loved ones, or whoever is with them. And so what we try to do is get home care nursing, which provides home care aides to help out with personal care, especially, as well as home care nursing, which helps deliver medications and do some assessments when maybe new symptoms come up. The home care nurse is key to communicate with the primary care providers and with the palliative care team that we usually involve at the Saanich Peninsula Hospital, the team that Leanne Drumheller is on. We also use the help of the community paramedics, which is a program that BC Ambulance has developed, where some more advanced trained paramedics learn about palliative care delivery and chronic diseases and can go into the homes when there's not an emergency, do assessments and help the whole team and help the person navigate this time as well as the people around them. So that's a nice extra resource we do have. We also support them with the primary care, the GP, which is either me or a locum or hopefully another provider that we're going to be hiring pretty soon, as well as the NP who works here full time. And at the end of, nearing the end of life, I always give my phone number to the family and to the person, so that it's been really lovely, because in the middle of the night, even if somebody is completely prepared, if things are going in an unusual, unexpected, or just difficult direction, then people will have a person that they can contact. There's also this really neat resource of an on-call nurse, a palliative care nurse for the province, and that palliative care nurse can be accessed by the family or the person, and they can also link and get some help with an on-call supportive palliative care physician through that program. So it's a really nice additional resource that we have. So as long as there's hands by family members or some dedicated people in the person's life to help deliver medications and just be there, then a lot of these extra things can really bolster the power that person has to stay at home until the dying day. We also have the lovely Transitions Spiritual Support, the Transitions and Dying Group, and Dying and Grieving Group. And they've been, in the past, there have been times where they've done hospice kind of support at the bedside. I'm not entirely sure. I'm sure, Linda, you're going to be discussing that a little bit later, but either for the person who's dying potentially, but often for the family or members of the extended world of that person, in case they're struggling with the grief or spiritual questions or whatever they might be having. So from my point of view, what I like to do is make sure that I consider what's going on for that person and working either alone, if it seems straightforward, or with a palliative care specialist. I usually link into the Saanich Peninsula Hospital for that. We come up with a plan for medications in the home for people who are dying. We try to anticipate different scenarios that can happen depending on what medical problem, what terminal illness or not the person is having, so that we can have a nice compendium of tools. And then with the home care nursing, we can get supports so that even if that person can't swallow anymore, we can still offer medication under the skin to help them stay as comfortable as possible. It's quite lovely, actually. So that's unique depending on the exact situation, and we're very involved at that point. So I think that kind of sums up what can happen on the island, and I will leave it at that at this point.
Can I ask you a question, Erin? Yeah. So if somebody thinks to themselves, I don't want to leave the island, how do you make the decision that staying at home and palliative care is, how does that
process go? Well, the thing is, what we try to do is figure out what personal resources they have in terms of right. friends or family or support network around them, so that if they do have people who can support them, then those people need to be brought into the conversation as early as possible and connected with us and with the patient. I'll say patient or person. And so that they can be fully aware of what could be coming down the line. Does that answer the question? So we start there, and I think that's the main thing. And then if somebody says they don't want to leave the island, but they don't have a terminal illness, then it's nice just to know that for myself, and we keep that in the chart as much as possible, so that others can access it if necessary. But if they do have that terminal illness, then we can start to get things in place, like the palliative care provincial benefits, and that covers medications. You know how I was saying there's you could get a compendium of medications into the home and all these resources. There can even be the home care nurse kind of does a safety assessment and also just a palliative care assessment of the home to make sure, maybe that person would benefit from a hospital bed that can lift them up a little bit or position them a little bit more suitably. Or maybe sometimes that bed can be put into the living room or somewhere closer in, so they don't have to think about going up and down stairs. I don't know. There's many different ways that we can get started, but usually it's just linking with everybody, sort of starting to just link. And then we do kind of frequent visits, as in once a month, maybe if they're not experiencing terrible symptoms. And then once those month, if symptoms become evident or apparent or difficult, then we can definitely just get started with making sure those are managed.
Well, and I just see Sandra asked a question about, is it necessary to have a family member involved? And I heard you say earlier that it really takes a village on Galiano to support somebody. So if there was family, but if the family didn't want to be involved, but there were enough friends to create a support network, I guess that would work as well.
We often see functional capacity go down. So the ability to get up eventually is not there. And so someone might be bedbound for a while. So in that situation, there's a fair amount that the home care aides can do, but they can't be there 24 hours a day. We don't have that capacity here. And so I think that is something that lots of people hope for, is that capacity to have a care aide 24 hours a day. I think that's the main thing here that we can't have. So really to provide kind of, to provide the medications and watch for those symptoms popping up, to make sure there's safety. Usually it involves having somebody present most of the time, if not all of the time, nearing the end.
So it could be a friend or a group of people whoever, it doesn't necessarily need to be family.
That's right. Whoever one's able to choose. So if a person has good family or even can hire somebody privately, that's totally fine if that's what they want to do. It can be very difficult to find that though.
So the earlier you can make that decision, the more you can get your team in place.
That's right.
And educate them about what they're going to be, what they need to expect.
And the family really doesn't have to do, often the family, I would say, doesn't have to do a lot of the, in case medical is worrisome, like they often don't have to be the ones delivering a lot of the medications, or they can learn how to deliver some, which is quite simple. And the nurse goes through that in detail, and many people can learn that skill. It's very, very simple. It's kind of like giving your dog a medicine. There's just a syringe that twists in. And so that's one thing, but it can be very hard. So it depends on what your family members are willing to do, or I say family, but it doesn't necessarily have to be.
Have to be family. Okay. Does anyone have a question for Erin before we segue along to?
Maybe I'll just add, like, some of the most challenging symptoms that can develop for people would be things like incontinence. Yeah. I think that tends to be one of the most challenging things to manage in the home. And so even in a family who's very well supported, as in they have lots of hands to help, sometimes there are things that limit people's ability to carry on, and sometimes just suffering can be very difficult to manage too. And so even with the best of intentions, I think it's kind of, I think of like the coming into the world and then the leaving the world. If we're too rigid when people go through birth plans, for example, if they're too rigid and not willing to move as necessary or change plans, then sometimes that leads to very disappointing scenarios, experiences that feel bad, worse than they really need to sometimes. Yeah. But if somebody has just kind of a general idea of their preferences, but some flexibility, then that's, I find, the best outcomes in that scenario, because we don't know what's going to happen.
Well, and that leads into another question, is if our best laid plans all of a sudden go sideways and we did need to be moved off an island because of the complexity of our situation, where do people normally go? If they went to Victoria, for example, where would they normally get
changed? So if this is during the very... And this could be discussed with maybe other people in the group as well. I'm thinking Leanne would have probably better answers, but I'll just mention that there's some wonderful palliative care wards for people who are actively dying. So we see them, they are no longer functioning. They might be sleeping a lot. Most of their day is spent in bed, that kind of thing. That would be potentially in a palliative care ward in like Saanich Peninsula Hospital, for example, or Royal Jubilee Hospital. And then there's some hospice houses out there as well. Or sometimes for like longer periods.
Thank you, Erin. Okay. Thanks, Erin. Whoops. Oh, look at this, Lori's. Yeah, it's been really wonderful to have you, Erin, leading us through this. It's been a learning opportunity for everybody. Yeah. So welcome to Dr. Gallagher. Romaine, it's lovely to have you here. I didn't mention in my introduction that all our panel people are have a Galiano connection, which is really quite amazing. So although Romaine's career has mostly been in pretty much probably all in Vancouver and across the country, she's retired now and has a place here on Galiano, which is terrific. So Romaine, I'm just going to turn it over to you and let you talk about what you're going to talk about.
Thank you very much, and thank you for allowing me to participate. I'm delighted to present some information, and what I wanted to deal with is a lot of people have ideas about palliative care that we're trying to change, because we want people to live as well as they can for as long as they can. And this is really what palliative care does. But there are myths around about, you know, palliative care is, you know, everybody sort of gets a really quiet voice, you know, whispering, and that's when you start the, must be when we start palliative care. So we really want to try and dispel some things. So I'm going to share my screen. And what I'm going to do is hopefully, you may already know these things, but I want to demythify palliative care, because I think we all know there are a lot of myths. So let me, why is it not advancing? There we go. Okay. Myth number one, palliative care exchanges length of life for quality of life. So I've even had my colleagues or have heard my colleagues have said to people, oh, you want your mother to have palliative care? Well, we haven't given up on your mother yet. As if you need to wait till the end of, you know, wait till we've done everything we can before mother can receive palliative care. So what do we know about palliative care? It's actually defined as an approach, so not a place, not a sort of a name, but it's an approach to care that improves quality of life for patients and families facing problems associated with life-threatening illness. How does it work? It's through, and notice prevention. I've highlighted prevention because much of what we do is giving people information, because I read a very interesting book that showed that mostly what people imagine it's going to be like is always way worse than it usually is. And so if you can talk about these things and what can be done, what can't be done, how, as Erin was talking about, how you have to be flexible, you have to have a plan A and a plan B. And, you know, how we can work together to help people have these plans of care. And what we try and do is identify symptoms early and treat them aggressively in order that people can still say, as I had the honor of looking after my mom when she died, and she said to me, what does dying feel like? Because I don't really feel any different. And that's what it should be like. People sort of say, well, what is dying like? Well, it should be living until the end. And we do this in a variety of different ways, addressing people's many needs, physical, psychosocial, and spiritual. Just to, people have a lot of confusion over what's what, because we use all these different terms. Because everybody likes to avoid dying. And if you look through a thesaurus, you will find that the only thing that has so many different names, it's either being dying has a ton of different names for it, and so does stupid. And the two of them, It's very interesting. So, you know, we could all talk about what our favorite, my favorite is falling off your twig, but there are many other ways that people talk about this. But you need to understand that we could say there's three different phases, and you'll see that palliative care is an approach to care. End of life is sort of talking about weeks to months and last days and last hours, just to kind of clarify that. The palliative care is not the little thing that we do at the end. We have multiple randomized control trials, which are the kind of trials that give the highest quality of evidence. And we look at comparing people who receive palliative care while they're still getting cancer care. And they find that it improves the quality of life, symptoms, and also communication with other healthcare providers. Some studies have shown that palliative care improves your mood. You have a greater sense of satisfaction with the care. Survival, you can actually survive longer, and they have better outcomes for the caregiver because the caregiver is supported. And I think all of us, if you've cared for somebody, and I would count myself in that, you realize it's a full-time job, and it is, it can be stressful if you don't have support. Recently, I would say in the last 20 to 30 years, have found that the earlier palliative care approach is taken in the illness, the better people do. And one of the early studies was people newly diagnosed with lung cancer that had spread beyond the lung, and they were randomized to receiving early palliative care and cancer care. And they looked at length of life, quality of life, and mood. The interesting thing is these people all had similar amounts of chemotherapy, but the people who had early palliative care had ranked their quality of life better. They had fewer depressive symptoms, and they also lived 2.7 months longer. Now that's as good as some chemo. So you might say, well, this is interesting because they had the same amounts of treatment for the cancer, but what made that difference, right? So there was another study done that looked at, well, what did the palliative care people do? You know, we don't have magic treatments, but we do treat symptoms aggressively. And we think that if you're in pain, or if you're nauseated, or you're not sleeping, or you're, you know, short of breath, that's a huge stress on the body. And so if we can take care of that, people will do better. The approach to illness is also different as well. So when people visited the oncologist, they talked about how their cancer was doing, what further treatment they could do, and how that might go. With palliative care, the difference was a different approach. It was talking about symptoms, about coping with the illness, but understanding the illness and understanding where you were at in the illness. And the reason why we think this makes a big difference is people make better decisions when they're fully informed of what's going on. That is on the understanding that that's how they want to do it, because there are some people, and they can do very well, people who say, you know what, I don't want to talk about this stuff, I'm just going to get on with my life, and I'm going to pretend this isn't happening. And you know, that's just an alternate coping style that may be somewhat challenging for family and friends, but we can work with all different kinds of people and help them to receive the care they need. So you might say, well, how the heck does that happen? People get confused about what do you mean? There's a big overlap between home-based primary care, which is what Aaron and your nurse practitioner and people on the island do, and palliative medical care, medicine, care. And you can see here in the middle, it's more around the practical things that we really overlap and work together. And, you know, most people will do just fine with this care. It's when people get difficult to manage symptoms, difficult to manage issues, and these issues can be physical, psychological, psychosocial, or spiritual, or family issues, or this or that. It really varies, and that's where usually we involve palliative care more. So myth number three, morphine and other opioids in doses enough to relieve severe pain shorten the life of the person and contribute to their death. And I've had a number of people say to me, well, I had to give my husband the last dose of morphine. I didn't really want to, but I had to because I was there providing care. And I said, well, why were you giving, you know, so I killed him, but it had to be done because he was sick. And I said, well, what did he have? And this person said, well, he had lung cancer. And I said, well, that's why he died. He didn't die because you gave him morphine. He died because he had lung cancer. And many people worry about this. And when they worry about it, they're asking people to reduce the dose and be careful and so on. It often results in people being uncomfortable. We've actually shown, really, I think, that if you treat symptoms aggressively, like pain and shortness of breath, people eat better, sleep better, get around the house better, and they tend to live longer, because we've shown that probably the number one thing you need to do to keep well into till your old age is to keep moving. And so if we can keep people functioning well, they will do better. So we have shown repeatedly in people who are taking opioids, which we are using to treat pain and shortness of breath, that there's no relationship between the dose of the opioid, the rate of the increase, and the length of survival. So, and what a person takes is a very individual dose. And it's a whole other thing that can be discussed at length. But you need not be worried about that, because these drugs are very, very safe when used appropriately for pain and shortness of breath. Myth number four, a DNR do not resuscitate, or some people say DNAR do not attempt resuscitate, means that no further treatment will be given to control the disease, and the focus of care is being comfortable. And so a lot of people are very reluctant to say, I don't want to be resuscitated, you know, I don't want to give up being, you know, saying I want to be resuscitated, because maybe I have to give up my treatments and things. And this is an unfortunate thing that happens, but it's absolutely not true. Do not resuscitate only refers to the situation of not trying to restart the heart and lungs should a person die suddenly from their disease or some other natural event. So, and it often gets confused with what kind of care people want, or discussion about, you know, the amount of visits to the lab or visits for tests and treatments and so on. So we obviously, you know, do not resuscitate is probably the most important issue for people on island, because, you know, resuscitation is extremely challenging on an island where the ambulance can take 20-25 minutes to get there. So, you know, a lot of people, once they realize that do not resuscitate means, oh, it's only in the case of, you know, it doesn't affect the ongoing day-to-day treatment of my illness. They will be a lot calmer about saying, well, no, I'm, you know, I'll take my chances. If the end of my life comes, it comes. So it's often a big worry for people to let go of this. So myth number five, depression, which is low mood, hopelessness, lack of pleasure and things, is common with those with serious illness because their life has changed so much and that it's part of the process of being chronically unwell. So a lot of people will say, well, of course I would be depressed. You know, I mean, it's pretty damn difficult having a chronic illness and knowing that you're nearing the end of your life. The interesting thing is this is a myth as well, because if you look at how common depression and chronic illness is, we know that it's a complication. So like if you lie in bed all the time, you're at risk for getting blood clots in your legs because you're not moving. It's like that kind of a complication. And so it can be treated, but we often don't recognize it and under-treat it. And if you look at some of the slide here that shows that it's very common in a lot of illnesses, and we need to treat this. And I always say to people, well, make sure you talk to people about this and say, hey, this can be treated. Because there's lots of people who are dying, or maybe very near the end of life, or maybe not, who still enjoy watching the hockey game, still want to meet and have fun with the grandkids, still have lots of things that they want to do. They don't want to talk about death all the time. And that needs to be kept in mind. So if people are saying, oh, I've had it, you know, this is no good, blah, 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 that hopelessness and sort of depression can come from a number of different ways. And I just, this is one of these strange diagrams where they have done survey upon survey of 300 and some odd people with advanced cancer. And they looked at what factors lead to people desiring hastened death. And they found that physical burden, you see at the top, that's the symptoms, the challenges of the illness, plays a huge role. And that's why palliative care is so important in being proactive and trying to deal with the physical burdens of the disease. And that contributes a lot to depression. You know, as you get older, that affects you less. If you are a person who has good self-esteem and you sort of think, damn it, I'm worth it, I need some help here, you know, you're more likely to do better. And you can see, though, that depression is helped by people who find meaning and peace in their life, and by spiritual and religious faith. But there's this interesting link between depression and hopelessness. And so if we treat people with depression, they actually have better mood, better quality of life. And this probably helps a lot for people to live longer as well. So those are some of the things that we know and why we advocate for people to sort of say, hey, I should still be enjoying my life, even though it's narrowing. And you've probably seen how people can be so resilient that they can sort of say, well, you know, I can't do as much as I can, but I've learned to do something else. And now I'm really interested in this, or now I do it this way. So people are incredibly resilient. And if you notice someone who's down and not their usual selves, and that it could be something that's very treatable. So how do you know if you're getting palliative care? A lot of people have said to me, well, what is palliative care and how do I know if if I'm getting good care, in other words. And I tried to think of the key issues, and I think you want to know that your symptoms are controlled and that you have someone you can talk about your symptoms with. That's very important, because many of the therapies for psychological and spiritual symptoms are talk therapies. And so there's that. You've got all the information you need. And remember, this information, different people have different ideas about what they want to know. So I have had people say to me, don't tell my sons, or say to me, don't tell my mother she's sick. She'll give up hope. Other people have said, well, I've actually had people say, I'll leave the room, you tell my daughter what's wrong with me. Everybody's different and everybody has different informational needs and will do things differently, and we need to honor that. I did have one funny instance where a lady said, you can tell my sons what's wrong with me, but I want you to tell me, but don't tell my sons you told me. So, there's all kinds of combinations we can cope with. And Aaron talked a lot about needing a village, and that's very true. But support for individual and their identified family is key. Aaron also talked about a plan of care. So many times what unnerves people is not having a plan, not knowing what to do. And there's also a key need of there's someone they can call when things aren't going right. So I figure if most of the people could sort of say, yeah, I've met these things, or I've got these things, and I'd be happy if any of my colleagues on the call wanted to chime in and throw in another one. But this sort of speaks to the kind of quality one should have. And as an advocate for palliative care, I know we have limitations on the island, and I would say we need to challenge those limitations. We need to say we have the right to palliative care provided as for every person who has chronic illness, and that we should not be letting our health authorities or our province get by without providing that kind of care for every British Columbian and every Canadian. So I think we need to challenge the system when it's not meeting our needs. There is reality, but there's also advocacy. And I will retire from this conversation now. I don't know whether we've got any time. Oh, I know what I want to talk about. One more thing. Am I done?
No, you can have one more thing. That's perfect.
One more thing. I wanted to plug Canadian Virtual Hospice. Because it's an online Canadian information service that is really, really good. It has long wordy articles for those of you who like to have every single detail. It has videos for people who aren't into doing a lot of reading. It's got a huge amount of information, and I encourage you to check that out. I have put down a number of resources here, and what they do, there's Caregiver's Guide, which, if you're someone at home and you think, how do I properly help someone up from a chair, this has got it. And some BC resources that I will put out, and I've put in the BC resources as well. And resources for grief. And I'll make sure that I give these slides to Lori, and maybe they can appear on the library website or something like that, or the healthcare center. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Romaine. I can, just by listening to you, I can really realize you have a wealth of information, and we'd love to be able to have you for an hour so you could share all your wisdom with us. I think, though, what you really speak to so importantly is the need for us to have that support and that encouragement, and not just of the patient, but also of the family, which was a beautiful segue to Leanne. And your area of expertise is exactly that, to support the non-medical needs of the patient. So I'm just going to turn it over to you and let you get started.
Well, thank you, Nancy. And thanks to the library and everybody who's made this happen. And that was wonderful to listen to Romaine and Aaron. Great to just hear everybody. So I also did a little PowerPoint, and I just spent some time really just think. I live, of course, on Salt Springs, so I understand a little bit of the smaller community, but I've spent quite a bit of time on Galiano in the last couple of years and have really been impressed by the camaraderie and community spirit that goes on there. And then, of course, as your palliative care psychosocial consult for the island, it's wonderful to join this conversation and kind of be in the crew. So, and you'll have to excuse me as I make sure I share my screen properly. There we go. Let's see if that works. Is that, everybody see that?
There you go.
Perfect. Great. Okay, so I just put together a little bit, and I figure a lot of what's going to happen is going to be a conversation as we go at the end or whenever. And there was so much that Romaine talked about and Aaron as well that I was like, oh, yes, there's all these pieces. So let's see where we get to. Oh, how do I? Hey, Lori, how do I switch to the next slide? Let me see.
You should just be able to advance with, are you on a Mac or a PC?
PC.
So your four arrow keys, you should be able to just, or try your space bar if you're in PowerPoint.
Yeah. Hmm. Nope. Excuse me, everybody. Actually, Lori, are you able to just do it for me?
I can, but I don't have your presentation.
Okay.
So I have to have a copy. I'm sorry. Just quickly while you troubleshoot, I'll just draw people's attention to the chat where I've posted the link to the virtual hospice. Thank you. A PC user has waded in and said there's an arrow in the bottom left-hand corner.
There you go.
Thank you. Found it. Okay. Thank you.
And in true Galiano spirit, that's our communications worker.
Thank you. That's great. So I wanted to just start with Cicely Saunders, who's really the founder of the palliative care hospice movement from the UK. You matter because you are you, and you matter to the end of your life. We will do all we can do, not only to help you die peacefully, but also to live until you die. And Romaine really touched on that, is good palliative care does that. And it does help people have quality of life. So what I just wanted to, you know, that when we're in these caring roles with people that we love or are taking care of, it's really about, you know, one thing I do when I'm working with patients or families, what have you, is really coming back to what's your relationship like with yourself? And what's your, because this is the starting place, and our relationship to ourselves, knowing ourselves, is sort of the ground by which we then move into connection with others. And so in that, and in the realm of dying, and in a culture that really avoids, like I think Romaine mentioned, like talk quietly and tiptoe around these things, and sometimes that's cultural, sometimes that's familial, there's lots of reasons for that. But what are our values and beliefs, and how does that sort of create a particular lens through which we see end of life? Our experiences will also add into that. If we've witnessed a beautiful death or a painful, difficult death, that will really affect how we kind of move towards the next experience. So when I'm working with people, I'll often use a wonderful theorist and educator by the name of Peggy McIntosh, who many, many years ago wrote an excellent article about unpacking the knapsack. And she was more looking at it from a lens of privilege around anti-racist and anti-oppressive work. But I often use that tool of the knapsack of like, how do we discover who we are in this experience as a caregiver, as a care provider, as a community member? And so, you know, our beliefs, life experience, culture, education, spiritual experience, what's in your knapsack around death and dying? You know, people often have sort of a real image of a good death. What is your good death story? And so really getting an opportunity to do that, a little bit of that internal work, because that moves into that relational space. So if that makes sense, just to unpack our own unresolved pain, our own losses, our own limitations. And it actually creates room for us to truly meet. And that's where the magic is. That's where true connection takes place, in my opinion. So it's already been mentioned, but now I'm just gonna get into a little bit of the basis of sort of what I wanted to bring to today. But then thinking a little bit around like a rural setting specifically, and Erin and Romain already talked about the goals of care. And this does become kind of a key kind of tenet in moving forward towards end of life. And I'm glad to hear Nancy say that you guys are doing advanced care planning over there, because that's really important and useful for friends and family supporting people at end of life. So goals of care are done by advanced care planning, or sometimes more informally, sometimes through advanced directives or people that like medical representative, legal kind of written up stuff. But this is for people that have capacity to determine that. And if you don't have capacity, it's often directed by a family, but ideally we have people, clients, patients have that done ahead of time around what their goals of care are. And that becomes sort of our roadmap. And then how do we support people in a rural setting? And a lot of this has already been addressed, but the limit of home supports. And I think that the nitty gritty day to day is really where it gets tough. And I think that's in a rural setting, but that's in Victoria too. This isn't just here or on a smaller Gulf Island, although I think it's quite pronounced on all the Gulf Islands actually at this point that I'm aware of. So those are home supports are used for activities of daily living. So that's getting dressed, bathing, you know, things like the basics. And then what is that family support and presence, friend support? The other piece that Erin's talked about is pain and symptom management challenges. And that's where, you know, it's kind of a dual when people admit into a hospice or palliative care unit. It can often be either a caregiver burnout situation or pain and symptom. That can be incontinence as well, or just unmanaged pain. I wanted to invite you to just think of any other challenges that you might have experienced yourself or can think of, and you can always pop those in the chat or speak up.
So. I have a question.
Yeah.
Leanne. So I wonder, If a person's values are very different from their families, how complicated is it for a person to And I think that's probably where do we unpack our stories about death and dying. But what are the challenges there when it might be me that wants something different than what my family wants? And I need to get my team together of friends to support me in what I want to do. Is that something that you encounter, and what are the challenges of that?
Yeah, that's probably number one for a rural setting. Thanks, right. Nancy. Yeah, and I get in, that's, I think might even be the next slide, but this is great, because that is where the grist takes place, where the client or the patient wants to be at home. Most people want to be at home. Statistically, if people are polled, the vast majority of people want to be at home for end of life. And then you've got the logistics of that and the impact of that on friends and family. So, you know, and of course we can teach people to provide sub-Q meds. That's what Aaron was mentioning, kind of like when people can't orally take medication, but these are scheduled and have to, you know, you have to have a pretty robust team, and it does often fall to family at that point. Right. I'm going to switch to this slide, because this is what you're bringing to the table, which is this whole notion of living with risk. And from end of life perspective, there is risk in end of life on a smaller, you know, in a smaller rural setting. And so when you're capable, you have the legal right to live at risk. And then as support, how do we help reduce the risk? You know, so that's one thing we might be looking at. Let's see how to reduce the risk. What's the team? Who's the team? How are they doing? How do we support them? Are they getting enough rest, food, all these sorts of things? So that can be more informal care around those key people. Recognizing that choice to live with risk impacts those involved. So, you know, family, friends, but also healthcare workers, there is a real moral distress that can happen for healthcare workers. It leads to burnout, where you've got someone at home who, like Aaron mentioned, when people are at end stage cancer, say, fatigue is a major issue, and then strength and being able to ambulate, you've got someone who's a huge fall risk. Mm-hmm. So how do we leave that person even for an hour? Mm-hmm. And there's an impact of caregiver burden, and burnout is a really real medical, can be a crisis, and it can actually lead to urgent admissions and sort of pretty, you know, yeah, it's not a, that's where there can be risk to everybody. Right. So how do we support people with their choices when they're capable of making that choice? And then that has a lived impact. And so my suggestion is a balancing act. It's requiring the patient's kindness, honesty, empathy, and non-judgment. Again, that knapsack piece, right? Like, what's my stuff? I might be very less risk adverse than my partner, say, or what have you. Like, we all have our levels of where we're willing to risk and where we're not willing to risk. But it also means supporting people must practice their own balancing act. And it's a tightrope of caring for themselves while honoring the wishes of the other. You know, I work a lot with families where people have made promises to their parents, I will take care of you at home to the end. And then they can't. And that brings on a whole other chapter of grief and bereavement. And so, you know, and people don't really quite fully maybe understand the logistics of what it means to have end of life at home.
Yeah.
And they innocently said, I want to die at home, you know, thinking, well, all the pieces will come together.
Yeah.
Even getting private 24-hour care, in Victoria, that's a challenge. So multiply that. So Being present to end of life. So I wanted to kind of give a little bit of a, okay, how do I just be in this experience of being present to someone at end of life? So again, that self-awareness, noticing where you're reacting or judging, and then take responsibility for that. Just when, oh, where is this in me? Where was this something of mine? End of life really invites us to be in a state of being rather than doing. And we live in a culture that is intense around doing. And so can we be, even in the moment of death, can we be with the person who's died and just be in that sacred space? There's a space that happens. And invite the people we're supporting who are supporting their loved ones around this. What does it mean for you to be? And even having these dialogues together can really be so beneficial. Listen and ask questions, entering conversations with curiosity. So just being open and letting the person who's dying be the teacher. And this is a beautiful discovery. Recognizing the dying's not a problem to be fixed. And that's hard. That's hard in a medical system too. That's hard in even the language of oncology is the battle against cancer. We won, whatever, you know, it's got this energy. And to be really aware of cultural, religious, familial issues that impact the dying person and their family and leaving room for this to unfold. I was part of the Wasatwin journey home on Saanich Peninsula. We did a big thing around palliative care with all the palliative docs there. And one of the things we learned and was a major takeaway was many First Nations people don't talk specifically about dying. Even the language is not dying or death. You know, so how do we then, and of course, we learned a lot more about the impact of residential schools on people accessing government institutions for end of life. So being aware, trying to stay conscious of privilege or of where you may not have a traumatic or a background issue. And then allowing yourself time to feel and be supported in the role of caring for another. So I think that, you know, Nancy, you've kind of talked about those informal communities, those circles. There's I don't know if it's Joan Halifax, but anyway, one of the writers of palliative care talks about the jeweled net. And I think it's a beautiful image. And is it? Yeah. And it so is. In each crossing of that net is a jewel, and each person is a jewel essentially that's holding that loved one or that cared for community member. So taking that time to really try to nourish yourself. And I'm going to end my bit here with a beautiful Joan Halifax. And if anyone doesn't know who she is, look her up. It's incredible. There's no one right way of dying. Dying holds huge variability, which can shift from moment to moment. Our job is to accept even the most unacceptable and unaccepting approaches to death and realize that they are normal too. We can look at this push-pull struggle as the waves of birth and death. Our challenge is not to learn to drown in those waves, but to ride them. Dying can involve intense psychosocial experiences, some pleasant and some inspiring and some very unpleasant. So sort of just to be. And if we're able to be in that state of being, it's not that there isn't doing. You might need to go get a medication, this and that. But how do we do from the place of being would be a bit of that invitation that I wanted to bring.
That's wonderful, Leanne. Thank you very much. It's I think the message that I'm getting from all of this is that even in its that there's a complicated kind of process to organize yourself into dying at home, that there is such an extraordinary simplicity in the just being rather than and letting go of the doing. If we can allow that, it's just a huge gift to everybody, I would imagine. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any questions here of Leanne?